Okay, November the 23rd, 1998. The survivor is Oscar Schoenfeld, Helga Weinbach, interviewer. We are in Beverly Hills, California, USA. It will be in English.
Today is November 23rd, 1998, and I'm interviewing Oscar Schoenfeld. My name is Helga Berliner Weinbach, and I'm interviewing Mr. Schoenfeld in Beverly Hills, California, and we're conducting the interview in English. Good morning.
Good morning.
To begin with, just give us your name and spell it for us.
Oscar Schoenfeld. Oscar, like O-S-C-A-R. Schoenfeld, S-C-H-O-E-N-F-E-L-D.
And what was your name at birth?
Ossi. He called me Oscar, but usually it was Ossi.
And?
O-S-C-I. O-S-Z-I.
And was it Schoenfeld also before?
Albert Schoenfeld.
And please give us the city and the country that you were born in.
And I was born in was Mukachevo or Munkac, and that was that time Czechoslovakia.
And the year? And
in 1923 was the year when I was born, which means that today I am 75 years old.
Very good. Let's begin a little bit with describing, as you remember it, your childhood in Munkac, and a little bit about your family.
I was born to the family. My mother came from Hungary originally, and my father came from small town, also in that time it was Hungary. My mother's family was not a religious family at all. I shouldn't say at all, but was not. In Budapest, and she was born in Budapest. In those days, Hungarians, Jews, most of them who lived in Budapest, most of them, they were so-called modern conservative or reform. The way like I understand, my mother lived and was born, and she didn't get too much of Jewish education.
Give us your mother's name and maiden name.
My mother's maiden name was Ethel, and her family was Alper, A-L-P-E-R. I understand that my grandfather Alper was a shoemaker in Budapest. My father, Alav HaShalom, went up to Budapest. He studied there. I really don't know how much he studied there. All what I know from the family is that he rented a room or a space on Kirayutsa, where my mother's parents lived. And there where he met my mother. My mother was 18 years younger than my father. And when she was 18 years, they got married. And from there it started the family. Evidently my father was a great influence on her that became more a religious person. A religious person in terms of Budapest. I really don't know how religious they are, but when I was in Budapest in the year 1942, I had an aunt there, which it was my mother's sister. And Budapest had an underground. And she took me, I went with her someplace, and I was standing not far away from the door. And my aunt tells me, can you picture yourself that your father was standing like this and he was also working and taking the tickets. He was working when he was young.
Taking tickets for what?
Taking tickets to people who are getting into the underground. I mean, like you are going to be in a train. There was an underground train that time in Budapest. So he was working like a kalos, they called him in Hungarian. And right away, when she told me, says, the first question I had, I asked her, and tell me what happened on Shabbat. After all, this goes 7 days a week. He said, what do you mean, what happened on Shabbat? He was working on Shabbat. That was that time, I think, 18 years. And when I heard that my father was working on Shabbat, here I was keeping him so high, I respected him so great, something happened with me. I cannot express, but it's just like if I would lose a certain respect to my father. So, and this was how, this is one episode which I can tell you from my parents.
That you remember.
That I remember very well.
Now, let's go back a little bit. So your father married your mother in Budapest.
Yeah.
And they had some children in Budapest?
Oh, yeah. My father had, they had about 5 children were born in Budapest. I come from a family where we have 11 children, 8 girls and 3 boys. And 5 of them, which it was one brother of mine and 4 sisters, they were born in Budapest. And before the First World War, for one reason or another reason, from Budapest, they moved to Munkács. It never occurred to me to ask, why did you move? I assume that it was the reason that he just couldn't make the right living in Budapest, so he moved to Munkács. And that was in the year, in the year 1918, or after the war, after the First World War.
Was your father in serving?
Oh yeah, my father was serving in the Austro-Hungarian army for the last 2 years, I understand. And my mother, Aleha Shalom, she was the one who handled the store. We had the store of paint store. We had paint store, the store name was Sivarvány. And the Sivarvány means in Hungarian rainbow, because we sold paint so many colors, that was the name. And
you think that your father went to Munkács already before the World War One, because they had this paint store there?
Oh yeah, no. My father went to Munkács somewhere around 1918. And the reason I say that one, because I have a sister who lives today in Israel, and she was the first one who was born in Munkács. And she is around 83 years old so today. Mm-hmm. So I figure that he went to Munkács in those days. Mm-hmm. Because I have I have another sister who was born in the year 1917, and she was born also. She was the last one who was born in Budapest. Uh-huh. So this is how I think that That is the time when he arrived to Munkacs.
Describe a little bit of your young boyhood in Munkacs.
My young boy in Munkacs, like all the most of us, we went to a cheder in Munkacs, I remember. And soon as I reached the age of 6, I went to the Hebrew Riyah Gymnasium, they called them. That was the Hebrew Beit Sefer Tarbut. Tarbut means culture. And there was a chain of schools starting from Lita till Czechoslovakia. So there was a chain of Hebrew school. I remember as a young man that I wasn't the best child in the class. One day, my teacher, who was also a very close friend to my sisters, one day my teacher hit me. She didn't behave. Evidently, I didn't behave right, so she hit me a little bit, and I hit her back. So this teacher. I even remember her name, Gerstein, told that one for my sisters. Can you imagine? Your little brother hit me. So at home, they took me, my father, and they asked me, how can you hit your teacher? So I said, she started. That was my answer. So this type of, she started, I didn't start. So this was my answer. So now you can.
What kind of character?
What kind of character that is. And then I went to the Hebrew Gymnasium. After 4 years, we will go to the first year gymnasium. I was a fairly good student. Especially, I loved the Hebrew language, the literature language. Even today, I can tell quite a few poems which we had to learn word by word. In those days, there were some very important, especially from Tanakh. We had some important passages like Shirat Dvorah, which was a song of Dvorah, who was a shofet, one of the judges, very famous, who took... who fought with Sisra, who was with Sisra. Sisra was the king. Pretty soon, I will tell you the name of the people where he was the head. And there is a beautiful song, which is written in the Tanakh, mm-hmm. when they were thanking Dvorah and her military head. And it was a very beautiful, and that they won the war. Mm-hmm. So even today I know that one. Then we had to learn about David HaMelech, the first, and other important from Tanakh. I was very proud of that one that I learned. I just loved Tanakh. The only subject which I wasn't able to grasp was the Czech language. We had to learn Czech. There was Czech hours twice a week. And somehow, the Czech language, we had to learn Czech. I wasn't able to talk. And
your mother tongue at home was?
My mother tongue at home was Hungarian. Mm-hmm. So there I had some difficulties. But when I recall, especially after the war, that here he was a city of 30,000 people. 15,000 were Jews.
Half of the time.
Half of the time. Very highly cultured city. And Munkach, besides that, it was a Hebrew gymnasium. And when I say Hebrew gymnasium, that was, they established in the year 1922. And the reason why I know that one, because my father, Alaf HaShalom, he was very, very active in that, in the school. As a matter of fact, we have even pictures from the curatorium, that time the board of directors, they called curatorium. I have them here somewhere on my desk. And
we'll look at them later.
He was part of that school. In other words, he was, in 1922, they started that school. And to think back that in the year 1922, there was no Hebrew language spoken in Israel yet, as much as today. There was nothing to think about it, that in 1922 there was already a school in Munkach, in Carpathian, who taught all the subjects in the modern Hebrew language.
Right.
All the subjects in modern Hebrew language.
So you learned mathematics and
everything was in Hebrew language. The only thing was Czech. Czech we had to learn. Naturally, that time we didn't have teachers. We had to, they got a woman, a lady, who was teaching us Czech. So it's just boggles of the mind. Here in Munkach, you had the Hebrew gymnasium. You had the Czech gymnasium. You had the Russian gymnasium. Russians, I mean, Ukraine gymnasium. You had the Hungarian gymnasium. You had a school, they called them Kereskedelmi.
Business
school. No, and they had that school, a seminarium for teachers, how to teach. Now, all these schools in a small town. And besides that one, we had the Hasidish. That was the great... When people ask, where are you? I just tell them, from Munkach. They don't know about the Hebrew Gymnasium. All what they know is that there was a famous rabbi there. There was a famous rabbi there, which it was. And they had a lot of yeshivot. And not just that they had yeshivot, they even have a printing shop there. Once a week was printing once a week there was a newspaper came out, the Yiddish Stimme, that was the name. The Yiddish Stimme, the Jewish Stimme.
Language?
Yeah, somewhere around the Jewish language, which it had it. And the name of that printing shop was Nikuda, which means a point, Nikuda. And there was a Hasidic, but mostly Zionist. It was established by a gentleman by name Goldstein, who today have children, grandchildren in Israel. So you remember those things, that in a city like this, and there was the Mocher Sfarim, writing books, Hasidic books, very important, Gemara, so far and so on.
Let me ask you this. You went to this Hebrew gymnasium,
yeah,
which was obviously Zionistic.
That's right.
What was your relationship to, or did you have a relationship with any children who were from Hasidic families? How did those relationships go?
Unfortunately, I didn't have, because I didn't get together with them. In those years, you get together with the friends of yours who are in the school. Later in the years, when I wanted to, my father, naturally, and I, but my father mainly wanted that I should learn more of the Hasidic
works.
And then they gave at the school, the Hebrew Gymnasium, had a teacher who after the school, after the hours, if you want, it was a volunteer deal, that you could go and he will teach you other subject in the which we didn't learn during the day. And that teacher, among the teacher was a gentleman by name of Gottlieb. That Gottlieb, a Yid met a bird, he was a Jew with a beard, with pears and Shabbat. With Shabbat, he was very stram. That was
it. And he taught in your school?
No, he didn't. Uh-huh. He was the only Zionist in the city, a Chassid. He was a Chassid. And he had not a liquor store, a kochma. They called him kochma. People came in there and they bought the schnapps, goyim, and he was a corner. And the evidence that business didn't go, wasn't a business that he was busy all day long. So he was disturbed a few times, but he was teaching me Hebrew. I mean, Gemara, Mishnah, mainly Mishnayot. And this was the only Hasid who got a certificate in those days to go to Palestine. You had to get from the British government, from this a certificate, they call them a visa. This is how you were able to enter to Palestine. It was amazing that here, very seldom, there were not too many certificate giving God. There were a few of them in certain cities in the world. Because the British just didn't, it was not an unlimited deal. So this man, because they recognized him, that Afalpi, even though that he was a very religious man, and a Hasid, and Bekish of Chulubu, was Zionist. And he and his family were able to go out to Israel legally. That must be in the year 1932, 33. As a matter of fact, he had two sons, and one son became the mayor of the city of Bnei Brak, which is a very religious city. So those are the things maybe which I remember from my boyhood. Then I got involved with the Zionist movement.
Describe that a little, how you got involved. What was that like?
In the Hebrew Gymnasium school, the teachers were Zionist-minded teachers. Most of them, they were not religious teachers, but the love for Israel, for Zionism, was great. There was one or two teachers who was religious, but the rest of them, they were not. And here they come and they started to organize Zionist youth movement. Some of them became Shomer HaTzair, like I had my one sister of mine was a very devoted Shomer HaTzair.
So that's completely to the left.
I had the brother, Alaf HaShalom, who was during the Second World War, he was in the Czech army from Palestine.
Describe that a little bit. He went to Palestine when?
He went to Palestine in the year 1940. He went to Palestine the year 38 from Prague. He was also in the Beitar movement, and he studied in the university in Prague, architect. But that the school had groups, and groups were competing against each other. There was Shmetzair, there was Kadima, which it was the middle road, there was Bnei Akiva, and Beitar. I somehow got involved with Vital. Don't ask me how come I got involved. I think, I analyzed that one later on, and it all depends who were your friends. If your friends were in the Mizrahi, Bnei Akiva, even me also, you got involved with that one. Most of my friends was Bnei Akiva. And I liked that one very much because Beitar was a very nationalistic
movement.
And when we grew up, we were like soldiers, we had to march, we went to the camps once a year in Munkaj. So this is how I became a Beitari. As I mentioned to you, we were 11 children, and among the 11 children, the ones who were born after in Munkaj, after the First World War, they all were in some kind of a group. And I remember at home, my father, he never got involved with our discussion at home. Me, my sister, my other brother, he just let everybody should be in his own group. He should be, should have his own mind.
Give us your father's name.
They call them Dezső. In Hungarian, Dezső means David. Mm-hmm. And he was one of the builders, not the builder, he was one of the group who established the Mizrahi movement in Munkaj, which Mizrahi naturally was a Zionist Orthodox Jews. And he was one of them. And he was very, very Zionist minded person. I never took my time or started to ask why. For instance, my sister's name mainly my sister's name were all Hebrew names. For instance, Tova means good, or in Yiddish means good. Gittel means. So her name wasn't Gittel, her name was Tova. The other sister of mine was Chemda, which is also a Hebrew name. And the third sister is called Yafa, which was Elizabeth. So that shows me, and that showed that already, that when they were born, like a sister, a brother was born in 1905, a sister 1906, the other one 1909, all had Hebrew names. And that was very, very, very strange.
It was unusual in that
time. Very unusual, that's what I meant to say. So, and this and how I got involved with Beitar, and we are very, very, I was very much involved in that one.
Now, you said that because of just who you hung out with and your friends, so you never really hung out with kids that were from Hasidic families, mostly with other kids that were from Zionistic religious families. What about non-Jews? Did you have any non-Jewish friends?
No, we did not. I did not. I did not. Non-Jews at all.
We're going to finish talking about this on another tape.
Thank you.
about your rather unusual background, yes, and the fact that not only were you Zionistic, but religious and Zionistic, and that your father was very liberal in the sense that he allowed his children to belong to these organizations, whether it be Shomer HaTzair, which is very far to the left, or something in the middle of the road, or something at Beitar, and that he didn't seem to want to force you in any particular mold.
I'm sure that he was very proud of us, that this how we grew up. Just to tell you one episode, how deeply I was involved with Beitar emotionally. In the year 1938, there was, I even call him today hero, a young man by the name of Shlomo Ben Yosef. Shlomo Ben Yosef was a Beitari, and in the movement, they taught us, or they told us, the difficulties with Jews have with the English, military people who that time ruled Palestine. And one day, this young man, they caught him with a bomb. Well, he wanted to bomb a facility. I don't remember if it was an important facility, a business facility.
A facility in Palestine.
And he got caught. And there was a mishpat. There was a
trial.
There was a trial, and he got difficulties for me. There was a trial, and the Earth Day.
The sentence?
They sentenced him to death. That time, even though that he was a Beitari, the whole Jewish people all over who were Zionistic, they wrote to the king, they wrote to different important people that they should forgive him as far as to hang him. Mm. So they should give him a life sentence, but not to hang. Didn't help. And one day they were hanging him. He was hung. And the newspapers, especially the papers which we got from the Beitar organization, told us that when he went
they hung him.
To the place where they're hanging, he went with the song of Beitar, and then he went with the song of Hatikra. Because he wanted to show that I'm dying for a cause. And that newspaper also wrote those days, it was how much he suffered, blah, blah, blah. I was at that time about 16 years old, 17, and I was so overcome with this one here, that here is a Beitari, a young man who goes under the tliya with a song in his heart about how good it is, tovla mudbada, you know, it's good to die for our land. It overcome with me. I had to go to the dentist one day. So I went to the dentist, and I, like everybody else, I hate the dentist. And they had to pull a teeth on me. And dentist told me ahead of time. It will hurt a little bit, but don't worry. It's real good. And while he was working on my teeth and drilling whatever it is, I was holding myself, and I said to myself, if this man was able to go when he knew he's going to die with a song in his heart, and he was suffering so much, wouldn't I be able to suffer now when I'm a dentist? So these little episodes stayed
in your mind.
And that shows
that you revered this man so much, dying for.
Right. So, and then I grew up.
Did you have any kind of profession that you wanted to be that you can remember before the war? Any ambitions?
I really don't know, because I was so much involved with this organization. I thought one of these days I'm going to be a Natsif. Natsif was the head of the Beitar in this Czechoslovakia. They always called him Natsif in Hebrew. Is a leader. I always thought that I would be a leader in Beitar. And this brought me to the occasion that the love for Israel and the love for the people was very big, very great in me. Munkács, or Munkácsevo, is situated about, I would say, maybe 100 miles, not quite, with the Polish border. The war started in the year 1939, and as we all know, the German army occupied Poland. It didn't occupy Hungary yet. It didn't occupy Hungary, but Poland. And whoever was able to escape, many young people, they tried to escape. And where would they escape? The only place where they escape, and I'm not talking about those who ran to the forest working where they were fighting with the partisans, was the border, Hungary. And here, once in a while, we see a strange people coming to town. You went to the shul and you saw a strange person in the semedes. And suddenly we started to find out that these people were able to escape from Poland, come over the border, and come over to Munkács. Somebody were able to come from Munkács. And They are in Munkács. What are they going to do? They don't speak a language, Hungarian language. Right away when they go out on the street, people recognize that they are strangers. Even those that the Germans didn't pick up, they didn't occupy Hungary. But the anti-Semitism was great already that time. And it came out all kinds of new laws, anti-Jewish laws, different kinds of laws. I'm not talking about that people couldn't go anymore to gymnasium, to gymnasium. The Hebrew gymnasium already started to fall apart. Also, there were new teachers because most of the teachers they left, they were anti-Hungarians and they went to Israel. And
how about you? When these laws came out, was there talk in your family? You said one brother went to Prague and then went to Palestine. How about when things started to get bad and these laws came down, was there talk from your father to say, okay, now children, I'm going to try to get you to go to Palestine?
No, somehow no. I had a, like I said, I had a brother who went to Palestine, and later, 3 years later, I had a sister also who went to Palestine. But I don't remember that father said, let's do something, so let's move. Especially in those days, my father was already 70, 72 years old. They weren't young anymore. And going back to that, those people who came from Poland.
Did you speak to them to find out what was going on there?
We did talk to them. We talked to them Yiddish. And whatever they told us, we just didn't believe it. It couldn't be. It couldn't be. And we organized an organization, Our Friend, quite a few Beitarim. In those days, we just didn't look anymore who is Beitari, who is not Beitari. And we all organized a group of boys whom we called the group Le'ezrat Ha'am, for help the people. And we, what we did is, when we found out, or when we find a person who came from Poland, right away we had to hide them, take them to places that the people shouldn't see them, the government, Hungarian police.
Talk about that a little bit. You were hiding Polish Jews from the Hungarian police because did they search for Polish Jews? Describe a little bit what that was like. And
that's correct. They searched for Polish Jews because they knew that somehow some people, Saints people coming through the border, but they just couldn't put their hands on that one. Number one. And number two, most of the Hasidim from, most of the Jews who lived in Munkacs, most of them came from Poland before the war, before the First World War. The Hasidic movement, or the very religious Jews, most of them came from Poland. They were not born in Hungary. Then they had also, Hungarian government came out with a new anti-Jewish law. Every Jew has to go, especially the younger people, 20, 25, 22, they had to go to a military groups once a week or twice a week. And whatever it is...
That's the Munkasogalat.
Yeah, Munkasogalat, that's right. And whatever happened, especially when they saw a strange person and they knew that he... We all had to have, everybody had to have, not just Jews. Everybody had to have a card with name, where you live, so forth and so on. So going back to those people, we organized and we were able to get them right away to the Besemedrish. It was a great, big Besemedrish, huge. Doubling there over 1,000 people. The Besmedesh never was closed. That is why they call them Beit HaMidrash. They are learning there. You went in and you see all over the walls books.
So it wasn't just a synagogue for praying, it was for learning as well.
Mainly for learning. But while you are there, naturally in the morning when you get up there, you slept there. You had to daven. They daven. Little people. And there, we were able to hold them there. We had to go and to buy them ticket to go to, they should take a train to go to Budapest. Because Budapest, was a million people lived. And stranger, everybody was a stranger there. They couldn't even go out to buy tickets because they didn't even know how to ask for a ticket. So this group, our group, was the one who took upon, who helped them. As a matter of fact, here in Los Angeles, we still have some of the friends of mine, like Kestenbaum Leutschi, who was in that group. Yes, he takes a great, right now he's with the Israeli band, and today is Monday, and last night we had a great banquet. He was the chairman of the banquet. He was one of us. Really, so I don't know, I don't say that we did it. Hundreds, it didn't go into hundreds. Here comes one, here comes one.
So but you took them, did you go on the trains with them to Budapest?
We went not till Budapest, but we went till Chap. Between Budapest, between Munkács and Chap, there we knew that there is police, gendarmes, Hungarian gendarmes, who are going to be on the train and just walking in and asking for papers. And as soon as they come, like I went once with them, another one was, as soon as they come, he was the person who's the refugee fell asleep, and we just gave it right away for here. This is my friend. This is his card. This is my card. One day, and this went on for about a good 6 weeks, which we did that one. No, more than 6 weeks. More than 6 weeks. One day, somehow, they caught that group going to the train station. They got the group and they got two friends of ours who were helping them going to Budapest, traveling to Budapest. And they started, the police started to question them. And like you well know, they didn't question the person with a kid's glove. And he started to tell who, those two persons, one started to tell, he wasn't able to hold on to, so he started to tell that this person is in the group, that person in the group. And the leader, who is the leader, Oscar Schoenfeld. Now we knew, I already knew, and we knew if somebody get caught, we had right away to go into hiding. And I went into hiding. I had a friend of mine whose parents had a hat factory.
A hat factory.
And I don't mean ladies' hat, men's hat. Hasidic hat. I remember Hasidic hat.
Strimals.
Not Strimals, no. You don't go every day in Strimals. You go with the Ran hat.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Hasidic hat. And there I was hiding in the attic. And he knew, naturally, a friend of mine, they brought me some food here and there. And
were you able
there to? Was. There was Rosh Hashanah, and Rosh Hashanah, I was in the attic. After, I don't know if it was the same day, second day Rosh Hashanah, or the first day Rosh Hashanah, that they took my father, the German police, I mean the Hungarian,
yes.
Took my father, and took my father to the police Department trying to find out from him, where am I? And they were holding my father there for over a week. And naturally, that time my father was already a 70-year-old man. They were hoping the police that I'm going to come around. And I did not give up myself. I was hiding there. And when I found out that my father, they took him to the police department, naturally, I couldn't hold myself back. But three friends of mine came to me, Dad, and told him, ask her, your dad is already free. Your dad is already free, and you must go away from here. And one night, I went to Budapest. I was dressed with like the farmer from with the heavy babushka, and
one of those big jackets.
One of those big jackets. And I arrived to Budapest. In Budapest, I rented a room. I had a family in Budapest, aunts, uncles, because my mother came from Budapest. And I was hiding there already in the year 1941 or 42.
And as you went to Budapest into hiding, did you see your father again?
Yeah.
In other words, you were in the attic. He was
no. At that time, I didn't see nobody. I went. They took me direct to the station. And I had already changed my name. I had already Aryan paper that I'd be able to show that I'm not Jewish.
What was your name?
Novak. N-O-V-A-K.
Who arranged for these papers for you?
In Budapest already. In Budapest. There was also a group who were trying to help all these refugees, especially young people. Young refugees people.
And they knew about you working from Beitar and...
They knew,
Let me just talk about your feelings a little bit at this time. Here you didn't see your father again. You knew he was free because they told you that the Hungarian police, state police, let him go. But you didn't have a chance to say goodbye to your mother or your father.
No.
And how did you feel about this as you were running away?
Very bad. This was the first time that I was away from home, and especially when it came holidays. Very bad, naturally. But they gave me a new name. They wrote me letters. They wrote me letters, postcards. But because I lived in a place, they knew where I lived. I had an address. And my name was Sharika Charlotte, like a woman, a female. Sharika Novak.
Those were the postcards. That's how they wrote the postcards to you.
Yeah, because they never knew that if the police is still looking for, looking after me. And the city, I was involved with the Zionist movement that I did. So many, you would ask me, what did I do there all day long? And I couldn't even tell you what did I do. Part of it, I was involved. My father had a paint store. And in those days, they took away the permit, business permit, the government from Jews. Somehow my father's store was, they didn't close, they were open because my father had some kind of heroism during the First World War. He was in the army. So my father asked me if I could see in Budapest to get him raw material to his business, because officially anymore, they did there was very shortage of material, number one, and especially they gave first, the manufacturer gave first the raw material to the non-Jewish people. And here, even though that my father's store was open, but he didn't have raw material. Like the main thing is paint. Those days they sold paint, powder paint, put them in a bag, kilo, half a kilo. But the powder paint had to be mixed with some kind of oil. Mm-hmm. So, and the most important thing which my father asked me, don't buy nothing on the black market. If we cannot get regular paint, don't merchandise, don't buy, just on a fair price, whatever the price is. So I made connection, because we had those connections before that law came out. And I met those people, I went to the factories. Somehow they got, most of them, they were very nice to me. They were Gentile people. Some of them were all Jews who worked yet with the Gentiles. And one day, for instance, one person said to me, look, powder is easy to get. It was easier to get powder, but oil, they call them firnais. That is an oil, lent oil. It was very hard to get. So that man said, right, you in Munkach, you must have a lot of small mills. And you have a lot of those, not propago, that is, what do you call that, growth against the sun, yellow, and had
sunflowers.
Sunflower has
seeds.
You can buy those ones, you can go around, take those seeds to the mill, and they will give you oil. Mm-hmm. And that oil, they will mix with. So this was mainly my
Day job.
Then there was a synagogue there, so I went to that synagogue. And naturally, I was in touch in Budapest with friends whom I met there. There were a lot of friends from Munkács, because they had to be in the labor camp there, and the station there. And that's how it went till suddenly we wake up and we find out that German army came in. German army occupied Hungary.
Okay. We'll continue with your story on the next tape. Oscar Schoenfeld. So let's pick up where we left off. You were in Budapest, and you were describing your life, and then you...
In the meantime, the Germans came in, occupied Hungary. Actually, by that time, we already knew faintly what's happening in Poland and what's happened to the Jews all around us. We still didn't want to believe him. Somehow, you just couldn't believe that something like this would happen. But we, you know, the youngsters, young people, again, we got organized with one aim and with one thing in our mind, how to save the Jewish youngsters from Mike, from the Beitar, from all kinds of Zionist organizations. There wasn't how could you save them? Now, Romania and the other side, that the Germans that time did was over the occupation. In other words, the Germans took away the Jews before a year or half a year before they came to Hungary. So you might say Romania was in Judenrein. There aren't too many Jews left, as we know, because the Germans took them to Bessarabia, Bukovina. That all belonged to Romania in those days. So our aim was to take groups of youngsters over to Romania and take them down to the Black Sea, because there is there are transports, boats, ships who can take you to Palestine. So we got organized. And again, I was involved in that one very much. My task was that those youngsters whom they sent from Budapest to Nagyvárad, which it was on the border between Hungary and Romania, get them down there. They had to stay sometimes and overnight someplace, two nights the most. While they are there, you have to take care of them. That again, people shouldn't see a stranger. So we had already got involved with Gentiles, that for money they were hiding here and there for a night somebody, one of the people. And then, late at night, the group which we had there, and I'm saying again, group, it was 8, 10, 12 persons. The group took them to the border. At the border, we had already connection with non-Jews. At the border in Romania and Hungary lived a lot of Seventh-day Adventists. And with those Seventh-day Adventists, I don't know, they loved us, whatever, but you could deal with them for money. They took over the transport over the border, which we had to go to mountain to arrive to Romania, to a city by name of Arad. And this went on a few months. And one day, when the group arrived to Nagyvárad, they arrived around 11, 12 o'clock. We put them to different places, one to go to the right, other one to the left. There were homes that you could put there. And at night time, we took a taxi who was working for our group already for the last 3-4 weeks. Got a lot of money for it, and he took the group down from Nagyvárad to the border. And the border, they already were the Seventh-day Adventists. And they took over the group already. One day, when we went down, and happened to be a few Hungarian, from Munkács people also, We went down with the taxi, and as soon as the taxi stopped, suddenly, the Gestapo, civil Gestapo, caught us. Next to the, we hardly got out from the taxi. And the taxi, so we had to go back with the same taxi, and they took us into the headquarters of the taxi, headquarters of the SS. There, next day.
This was in back to Budapest you went?
No, they took us back to Arad. Back from where we started.
So from Nagyvárad, you
from
mean?
Nagyvárad, yes. Nagyvárad, I'm sorry. In this age, my mind doesn't work.
It's working perfectly.
Next day, they took the whole group back. They gave it over to the Hungarians, the Germans, gave over to Hungarian SS, or whatever the group was, and they took them over. And they were in Budapest, in the ghetto. Some one or two of them were able to escape there somehow, and the rest of them, we don't know whatever happened. All what we know is that they never came back, took him to Poland. I was staying. They wanted to talk to me, and I stayed in the Gestapo in Nagyvárad. And here they found out that I'm the group leader there. Naturally, they started to talk and to ask questions. Who you are? From where are you? Who is financing you? Where do you get the papers? Because most of those people had Irish papers. I mean, not Irish, but Aryan paper. And
what did you tell them?
In the beginning, I didn't tell them nothing. But like I told you, comes a time when you just cannot hold you, no matter what. So I did tell them names, places. For instance, where is the group? So the group is in Shiputsa. It's a name, but it was the organization, the Jewish organization in Hungary, in the main. So everybody knew that Shiputsa is the place. And what was the name there? And I gave him some kind of a name. With whom did you get contact? So I gave them a name. I didn't give the name which I knew. I just gave a name. I stayed in that prison for about 3 weeks, maybe three weeks, because I really never knew why they kept me. I knew in the beginning why they kept me. I thought maybe that they are going to double check that what I said it's true. I thought so, and I was in that cell with another Jewish man whom they caught from our group. And that pretty soon I will give you the name, I don't remember. He had a very wealthy person who is not from Munkács, who was from Szatmár, another city. They knew of him, either way, who he is, and they kept him there. And after a week or so, they let them out, they called them out, then he came back. It happened about two or three times that they called him out, and he came back. And he tells me that what they want from me is that I should sign over my factory to them. Naturally, I was going to sign him. I don't have no family anymore. I was the only one who was in the whom family left. And he told me, Oscar, don't worry. When if I leave, then you come with me. Don't worry. I know who you are, blah, blah, blah. One day he just left, and I stayed alone. I stayed alone in the cell. Now, that prison in Hungary, it was a three-floor prison. The prison was together how do you call that person who, not the defender, the accuser.
The prosecutor.
Yeah. The prosecutor, but no, the head of that prosecution, they always stayed next to the
prison.
This way they don't have to carry the prisoner.
Still that way today.
I was on the third floor. I was by the Germans, because they caught me, the Germans. The first and the second floor were the Hungarian, a Hungarian prison. They caught all kinds of...
Which was a better place to be, in the German or the Hungarian prison?
I wasn't in the Hungarian, couldn't tell you that, but...
What was the
there
reputation?
There was no choice. There was no choice. Nobody wants to go to SS. And when you are in a prison, you have two things which you think on the front. There's nothing else which are the things which your mind works. That you should have food to eat, and how to escape. Nothing else. I knew that sooner or later they will take me someplace. And somehow, I don't say that I was smart is another word. I just said to myself, I'm not going to go to Auschwitz. I will do everything not to go to Auschwitz. In the meantime, so I was under the German military upstairs on the third floor.
Was there ever any thought, never mind that they were going to send you to Auschwitz, but they could kill you right then and there?
No. This didn't mind. This didn't go in. No. In the meantime, with our group, that group which I was associated, they have two young men who was in this group, and I was in touch with them, and they knew right away they caught me. Somehow or another, I cannot tell you exactly how it happened, but as a matter of fact, I talked to the young men, my age, who lives in New York, and I got some money from them.
He snuck money into you?
Yes, somehow. I don't know exactly how it was. It seems to me that we had in contact there with not reputable women who for money did a lot of things. And it seems to me that somehow to a woman like this, I got the money. Here the Germans, I befriended with Germans upstairs, and since I had money with me, I gave them here a few dollars, it was penger, that they should go out and buy some beer to drink, because I saw them drinking a lot of beer. And I befriended a little bit with them. In the meantime, every day, the prisoners, they took us down in the
courtyard
to walk half an hour, I think, twice twice, I think, or once, twice a day. Now, since that, and later on, when we went up, the Hungarians took down their prisoners. So we were not together. I wasn't together with no Hungarian prisoners. And I was the civilian. The rest of them were military people. Some of them who ran away from the front, some of them who committed all kinds of crimes. So they went, they were there. I went down one day, walking in the courtyard, and there was a ping-pong table under a tree, and I see there Hungarian guards are playing ping-pong with a young lady. A young lady, in my eyes, she was 16, 17 years old. Who is that lady? That lady is the daughter of the prosecutor who lived there. And they were playing. So when I saw that, each time when I passed by them, I talked to them Hungarian. But you couldn't stop. Yes, they found out, they used that I'm Hungarian. They were very upset. How come that the Germans are holding me as a Hungarian citizen? Why not the Hungarians are holding me?
Did they know you were Jewish?
No, they didn't know I'm Jewish. They thought I'm just a regular. They didn't know who I am, what I mean. And this went on for days, and I told them, you know, I have a great time upstairs. They don't bother me. As a matter of fact, they let me out from my cell, which they did. They let me at evenings. Around 7 o'clock.
Is it because you bribed them?
Because that's right. And they let me out for about an hour and a half. I was with them in the cell playing cards. You hear the radio with the German music, blah, blah, blah. So I felt a little bit free. And one day I said to myself, and I said, I'm going to escape somehow. And here, one day, when I was walking, I told for the girl, you know, tonight I'm going out to buy beer for the German guard. And the rest of the Hungarian guards, they heard me. They heard me that when I told them, look, I'm going to be anyway free, so the next day, well, tonight I'm going to buy for them some drinks. And at the gate of the prison was under Hungarian guard. The Hungarian guard, they were responsible for it. Sure enough, one evening, that night, or maybe in the night, the second night, but that night, I think, I picked up 3 empty bottles. I was in their guard room. Then, while they were drinking, I picked up 3 empty bottles that I'm going to go out and buy beer. Now, the Germans, they never sent me out to buy beers. But I knew that the Hungarian guard wouldn't know what's happening. So I had 3 empty bottles. I go down to the second floor. It was already dark, started to be dark. And I hear, who are you in Hungarian? And I tell him, this is my name, and I'm going to buy beer for the German guards. He didn't say nothing. Then I go down to the first
floor,
and the same thing happened. Who are you? What are you doing? They were just surprised. I told them, didn't you hear that I told for that girl that I'm going out? Oh, yes, I heard that. So let me go. I arrived to downstairs. I go direct into the guard room, and I just asked an Hungarian, Jancsibach, that was his name, what kind of schnapps do you like? He says, why? Because I'm going out to buy beer. They sell the same time schnapps. Give me that empty bottle. I took away an empty bottle. And I'm going to bring you back. The man opened the door, the gate, and I walked out. Look, you monkey, nobody would believe me. And from there, I went right away to a room that lived there. A girl whom we knew before, Gentile, and she knew that we are working. She knew she was under our payroll, so-called. The next day I will go over to Romania. That next day she comes home. She says, you cannot move out from here because the whole city is looking for you. The Germans are looking for you, the whole city. So you cannot go out from here. Have to wait a few days, which I waited there for about 3 to 4 days in her house. She fed me. And
what was her name, by the way? Do you remember?
Whatever name I would tell you, I really don't know. I really don't know. I know the first name, family name, but anyway.
She basically risked her life. She basically risked her life.
That's correct. That's correct. But she was a type of a person for money. She did. She was a girl who
did things for money.
For money. That's right. And the main time the group we were outside, they knew where I am. And again, after 3 or 4 days, they sent after me one of the Seventh-day Adventist person. And they put me a heavy coat, like a palm with a head. And this is how I walked with him till the border. It was about six kilometers from the city to the border. And there, after it was dark, he gave me to eat. And this Seventh-day Adventist people, I want you to know, every night when they took over a group, they fed us. And he said, look, you pray to your God, and I'm going to pray to my God, that we should arrive safely. And thanks God we arrived. I arrived to Romania the same day when the king capitulated. The king of Romania capitulated for the gave up.
For the Russians.
And that day I was in a U.S.
You were in Nodvarad when the...
No, that day I was in Arad.
In Arad.
In Arad. Arad was Romania.
Describe that day when they surrendered.
Oh, I wasn't there. They surrendered. They surrendered the capital.
Right.
In Bucharest. But everybody was elated. Because the Hungarian, they started to, they were that time already officially with the Germans, and the Germans were pulling back to the west, and they captured Arad. 2 or 3 days before it was. The Romanian king gave up the world. And they already started to build ghettos in 3 days. And naturally, it wasn't finished up, and they didn't have time to take away the Jews. But Alba, you asked me what I had in my mind. When I went with Arad from Arad to Bucharest on the train, what I had on my mind is that the previous group whom I took over to the Seventh-day Adventists, when they went on the train was bombed by American
Bombs. By American, the Air Force.
The Air Force, because they went to Ploesti. Ploesti was the largest oil field in Europe. Largest. So they saw a train going that way, so they bombed that one too, because that's an enemy. They considered that one as an enemy.
Sure.
So all what I was thinking is that two of the persons who was among that group and I took them back, they got killed on that plane, on that plane before. And you can have all kinds of thoughts in your mind. In the meantime, I had two sisters, which I saved them. I took them out from Munkács.
Describe that.
From the ghetto. When the Germans came in, we all tried to get all kinds of papers, false papers, to prove that you are not the Jews. And this was our group, and a lot of people did that from groups. And after Pesach, was it? I knew already that there is a ghetto in Munkács. And I knew already that my parents are already in the ghetto. And I said to myself, I must do something. So the ghetto was open certain hours a day to go out, to buy food, certain hours a day. I went to Munkács by train, and with
false papers.
False paper, and arrived already to another station, which I knew that the next station is Munkács. Went into the bathroom and I changed my papers and I put on my Jewish star. Put on the Jewish star. And I went straight to the ghetto. And the ghetto was open in that day. I mean, in that hour. I had with me all over false paper for my sisters. I didn't take no false paper to my father or my mother because I knew they are too old, but what am I going to do with those people? Three of my sisters, the oldest sisters, they didn't want to leave the parents. Whatever is going to happen with father and mother, it should happen with us. But the two youngest ones, I said, at least let them have a chance. They can move around. Naturally, it was very hard feeling so far as my parents gave them permission to leave the ghetto.
We will continue this on the next tape. where you left off. So you went back, you put on your star, you went back into the ghetto.
And I went into the ghetto, and it was naturally a very, very hard, goodbye, which we said. And I left back, I went back either way to Budapest.
And your sisters, you had the papers for the younger sisters.
Yeah, they came 2 days later. Somehow, the reason why they didn't come, 2 days later they came.
Just to jump a little bit, those two sisters came to Budapest under false papers.
That's correct.
And were they hiding the whole time in Budapest? During the rest of the war?
No, they were hiding.
They were hiding.
But I'm not. So I went back to Budapest. We knew what was going to happen with my parents and my three sisters. And that day when my two sisters supposed to arrive, I was at the station, and only one sister arrived, Irene. She was the youngest one. She happened to be here living now in Los Angeles. The other one, I'm sorry, that was my this Eva, and Irene didn't arrive. What happened? She got caught on the train. Somebody recognized her, that she is from Munkach and the daughter of Schoenfeld, and they took her down. And they took her and another girl, there were three of them. They took them to Ushhorod. Ushhorod is another city, 28 kilometers from Munkach. And they put them there in the ghetto. There they were staying. And I just could not live with myself that my sister, it was me who made them to get out from the ghetto, and now she's in another ghetto. Especially to ask my father that he should permit the two girls to go out from the ghetto and to go like live in a ghetto. He didn't want to let them go. He was afraid. So it remind me in the a story which I learned in the Chumash in the Torah when Jacob, who loved Yosef, after they found after the brothers realized Yosef found out that this is the brother, and they ask. And he asked him, where is the youngest one? Because the youngest one was his brother, actually, from the same mother, from Rachel. And so the boy said, the rest of the brothers, he is at home taking care of father. So he said, I want to see that. Wrote back, gave them, and bring me that younger boy. I want to see him. Otherwise, you'll be in problem. So they arrived back to the father. And they told the father, look, we have to take Benjamin with us back because otherwise that man doesn't want to see us because he doesn't want to see us. So Jacob said, it's written that Jacob said, not Jacob, the one Yehuda, one of the sons, Anochi Arvenu Miyadi Tevakshenu. I'm going to guarantee if I don't bring you back, Benjamin, then you should take me and with my children. So anyway, when I remember this one here, said, no, I must do something. I'm going to go to Ungvar to take out my sister. My sister. I went to Ungvar with another Gentile boy from our hometown who was the boyfriend of a nice Jewish young girl who happened to be here also. And I said to him, you must, Moses was his name, please come with me, because I just don't feel safe to go by myself. I just want you to be there. You don't have to do nothing. And I talked him into it, and he and his, and a friend of his, two Gentile boys and I, we went down to Ungvar. And we went down to Ungvar, we took a taxi, anyway, we arrived to Ungvar. I had a cousin, I had a cousin in Budapest, and she lived in Budapest. There was no ghettos in Budapest yet. And she tells me, if you go to Ungvar, that here is a name and an address. Go see them. These are my second cousins from my father's side, not mine. And maybe they will help. We arrived to Ungvar. So where shall I go? So I go to that man. Kovács was his name. That was his name. And they didn't want to let me in at the door. Everybody was scared. They were Jewish people. And I talked to them, and I said to them, look, I'm the family of Schoenfeld from Munkach. You must know somebody. I'm the son of them. You don't believe me who I am. And she started to ask me questions about the family. And she asked me, do you know somebody in Budapest by name Gizzy? Sure I know about Gizzy. Here is the paper. She gave me your address. Mm-hmm. Then she let me in. And I told her what happened to my sister. She said, look, I don't know if I could help her. I don't know how, but you go and wait for me next to the Ung, next to the Ung is the name of the river there, and let me see, wait for me, let me see. But that was in the morning, about 5 o'clock, I see my sister and a girl walking towards me. It was raining, and I took them to the taxi, and we went back to Budapest. The interesting thing was, how did she come out from the ghetto? Yet the ghetto was not finished in Ungvar yet. They didn't have a kitchen there, so they brought in food from the outside. From the Jewish, the Kehillah had a, from the Kehillah. And every
from
day.
From the Jewish Community Council.
Yeah, from that city. And every day, here was a wagon, two wagons with a horse here, a horse with bread, a boat, in the food, and took out later on the empty food, and them to a,
containers.
Yeah. And one of these containers, when they took out, the outside, was my sister and that other girl, and she was dressed like she is part of the kitchen group. And she got off from the wagon, and she came out.
So this cousin arranged all of that.
The nice thing about it is there's a gentleman, a family by name Jackson here, which we found out after that he was the one who was
taking the horses.
Yeah, on that one, he was the one who knew about my sister. He didn't know she's my sister. Who took out those two girls.
And not Jewish. Was he Jewish?
No, he is. He's a part of the ghetto.
Oh, okay.
He lived, his passed away a few months, years ago. His wife has lived here. Hard day, she said. So then I was in Budapest.
So let's pick up the story. We went back a little bit, and then we, from where we were, that Romanians had given up to the Russians.
Yeah.
And then you went to Budapest, to Bucharest. How long were you in Bucharest?
I think that I was about 5 or 6 months. Do you know I know about 5 or 6 months? Because in January, the Russians occupied already not a part of Czechoslovakia or Hungary where I lived. So I know that in January I went back to Munkács. I went back to Munkács.
Of 1945, yeah.
1945, end of January, yeah, mm-hmm. Because that was already occupied. And I went there, naturally, where would I go? I'm going over there to see if anybody from the family is going to come back. The second night when I arrived with a group. Midnight, there's a knock on the door, and they take away one girl. There was one girl with us, Mrs. Sunyak, and we were very worried.
Who took her away? The Russians?
Police. The local police. They were mm-hmm. Russian, but not Russian.
Hungarian.
No, Hungarian, who spoke Russian. And we were very much worried what happened. So next day, all what we know, that she is in the prison in Munkács. And the police think that she is a spy. And there was a friend of mine who was a partisan, who was a Russian partisan, who was also staying with us there. When we came, he was already home. And he can do everything. He was that type of a guy. I'm going to show them I'm a partisan. And he had a revolver, he had the permit to be a revolver. So he's going down, says, I'm going to bring her out. He went down. And they never let him out. And next night, all of us, we were about 8 or 9 persons who lived in that apartment, all of them, they knocked on the door and they took us all to the prison. Why did they take us? What did we do that you are taking us to the prison? You came from Bucharest, yes, you know. And you came with one seal, what? To tell the people here that they should go to Palestine. So that you came here to take away, to tell the young people, go to Palestine. No matter how much we said, no, we don't even know, we don't want, we didn't talk to nobody, we just hardly came. No, we know that you came for that and that reason. Why else would you come? They didn't take that reason that we came to see if our family is back. No, you came as a spy, so far and so on. So we stayed another week there. And a week later, here, they call us in, one by one.
This is all, you're in a prison now. You're
all in the prison.
Under the Russians.
Under the Russians, but the prison was not, the Russians were not in charge of the prison, was the local people. The Russians gave over to the local police. Then they came up and said, you know, now we know why you came back. You came back to make a propaganda that this place, Carpato Rus, that was, should belong back to the Czechoslovakia. That there's going to be an election in a week or so. And you came just to make trouble that this place shouldn't belong to Russia, should stay Czechoslovakia. No matter how much we told them, nothing happened. One midnight, we were in the cell, they take me out and they throw me into a cellar. It was dark. And they told me cellar, and suddenly when I touch here, I feel somebody is next to me. And he started to talk to me in Hungarian, who are you? And I told him who I am. He says, you know, they throw us in here also. I don't know why. I don't know why. Even if I say it. Later, an hour later, they threw in another man. And that man was screaming and yelling in Yiddish. Oy, that my heart gets much. That they really are suffering much. And, you know, I'm from Poland, and I want to go to Palestine, and they caught me at the border here, not far away was the border, and I don't know what I'm going to do. Do you know if one day they will let me out, he says. One day, well, if I want to go to Palestine, how do you go there? Whom are you going to get in touch? You are young, and I was almost open my mouth, almost. And the gentleman who was next to me, he was 20 years older than I, he held my hand. And he started to talk in Yiddish. Look, we don't know nothing. We came here, wanted to see our family. They just don't want to believe us. And we don't know nothing about how to go to Palestine. We don't know how to, we don't want to do to propaganda. We want just to go home, to be home, and see if the family is going to come down. And, but an hour later, they opened the door, and it was dark, and that man was, who just walked out, whom they threw him. And all but he said, Heble, Inan, Alcena, Zeiger, Hebra, and at 9 or 10 o'clock, you all are going to be out. Came 10 o'clock, they opened the doors, and they were out. Now, we had 30 days in the cellar, and you looked like you never shaved.
Did they give you food, proper?
No, proper. They gave food. But
did have food?
Oh, sure. So we go on the main street, in that city, because some of them, they knew the main street, that there is food to eat and a barber to eat. And here, suddenly, a man comes in front of us, and he says, I was the one who came to you at midnight. I was convinced that you are not spies. I was convinced that whatever you said is truth, and that's why you are out, because I was convinced.
So this other
that
Jew...
That man was a Jew by name of Elephant. Elephant, that was his name. Who was a communist. The rest of the people, they knew him that he's a communist from before. So...
He was trying to catch you in a way.
With me, the group. He wanted to find out through. He was a spy. Mm-hmm. And he was working with the local. So this is how we got out. I said to Munkach another week or so, 10 days, and I went back to Budapest.
Did you go to your house? Was there anybody in your house?
I went to my house. I went to my house the first day that I write to New York. I mean, to Munkach the first day. And I saw the house. People were living there. Russian soldiers, not people, Russian soldiers living there. And when I arrived there, I found two Russians was taking out the books and the bookcase in the backyard, and they burned all the books, and from the bookcase they cut them to pieces because there was no heat in the house, and they put that one. So what else can I tell you?
Okay.
I can tell you stories. I mean, not stories. All what I can tell you is that the great Ribbono Shel Olam, he was watching on me, over me. There were a lot, many times, a lot of occasions that I was almost in the hand of the Gestapo, on the street, at the train station, many places. If I tell you that one, I just, first of all, I don't have courage to tell you all these things because it hurts. It hurts very much. And I arrived here later after Germany. I arrived here.
Just to back up a little, were you in any DP camps?
No, I was not in a DP camp at all. I was not in a concentration camp. I was not in a DP camp. I was 2 or 3 days. Oh. See? Yes, I was in a DP camp. There was a DP camp, there was a group, a lot of Hungarian young men, young families. They had the opportunity to go out from Hungary. The borders were not yet fixed, so the borders were open. So I went in a group where it was my 2 sisters whom I helped them to save their life. And as a matter of fact, I never talked about it, not with my sister, to say to her. Anytime there is always some
friction
between sisters and between brothers. Never did I ever said to my sister, is that the thing what you are doing to me, that I saved your life? Never. But on October the 6th was my birthday, the 75th year birthday. And as a surprise, my daughter, Esther is her name, she wrote to my friends and relatives, and she asked them, she sent in an empty blank paper, you write down whatever you know about my father, and we will make an album on that one. Because this will be our present to our father. And sure enough, we got almost 200, which 200 sets of this professor. And one and that sister, my young sister, she wrote me at 2 pages to telling me how much she loves me. That I shouldn't forget, that she forgot, that don't think that I forgot what you did for me and for my other sister during the war. So what else can I tell you?
Well, just to finish the story up, to make it a whole, you said that you were after the war, you were in a DP camp.
Yeah.
Do you remember the name of the DP?
Yeah. Leipheim was one, and Leipheim is around Ulm, is a larger city, big city, Ulm. And then I went to Wasseraufingen, and so another DP camp. And the reason for it is that in Wasseraufingen belonged to near Stuttgart, belonged to a different quarter.
The zone
was the same, but the American consulate was in Stuttgart. First it was in Leipheim, then in Stuttgart, because I had a chance to come out to the United States easier and earlier I was 2 years back and forth in DP camp.
Did you meet anybody special in any of these DP camps?
Yes, I met a lot of people there. And I met my wife. That time she was a 16-year-old girl, young girl.
Give us her name. Give us her name.
Alice.
And her maiden name was?
Was Newman. Alice Newman. Alice. Alice. Everybody called her Alice. Alice is in English. Mm-hmm. And she was there with her parents and her sister. And there were not too many refugees with parents because they lost their parents. They were together and somehow I met her at the camp so far. So, and one day the father, her father, at Shabbat, when I was davening because we had a shul, he said to me, you are alone, why don't you come over to us and have lunch with us? So this is how I really met the family. A few months later, I came over to United States. I arrived here in July the 2nd, and they
what year?
Came
what year?
Year 1949. And they, my Alice with her parents, arrived 3 months later to New York, or Boston. I arrived and I came direct to Los Angeles because I had here a sister who was our oldest sister alive, and she was caring about and loved all the family very much as she cared for everybody, and that's why we came here. And then another sister came, so we were here, three of us, started to make a living. I remember I was working in a factory, paint factory by name Sinclair Paint Company. And the reason why I was working in the Sinclair Paint Company, because there was a painter who bought here, who was the customer of my father, for sure. And my older sister knew that man, and he knew that I'm here, so he said to my sister, look, I can get a job for your brother, Sinclair Paint Company. So I went down, I worked almost a year. At evenings, I was teaching Hebrew in Huntington Beach. No, not Huntington, there's Huntington Park. Yeah, Huntington Park. And after a year, I quit my job there, and I became a salesman, a vacuum cleaner salesman. There was a group here, again, refugees, about 12 of us, and two Americans, and we bought a vacuum cleaner. We were salesmen, and we made a very nice living. And after working, after 3 months working as a salesman, I went into manufacturing hessic. Hessic is a wood, nice wooden box. We put on them cotton upholstered with plastic, with a lid on them, and when you open, you are able to put in the vacuum cleaner. Because the biggest problem when they ask us, how come you didn't sell this, you didn't sell that? The main problem, we said, that we almost, this hessic was for a close-up. To close the deal, you give away a hessic. That will clinch the deal. So, and we always had problem with the, when they manufactured the hessic in New Jersey, in New York. And that time, it's written on the box, red, and it was blue, never, very seldom it was the same color. We never opened the carton. Came the carton, we brought them in. We had a lot of problems with hessic, a lot of problems. One meeting, everybody was saying, not everybody, 70% of them said that Hasek is the problem. Owners said, look, what can I do? They manufacture them. I am not a man. I am not manufacturing it. And it came in those days, the plastic was not yet so perfected. So when it came from New York, from a cold climate, and it came here, it was a warm climate, it split here and there. Mm-hmm. So when I heard all those things, after the meeting, I went over and I said to the owner, "If how would you like to have a local source of hasek? How I would like? I would love it. Didn't you hear what everybody is? And said, why, you know somebody?" And I said to him, "Yes, who? Me. You? What do you know about hasek?" "I don't know nothing, but give me 2 days." This is how I went into business to manufacture hasek.
We will finish your story on the next tape.
Thank you.
Decided that you were going to save the day by manufacturing hasseks and make yourself a better living.
And make it, that's correct. And I was very, very successful because the factory of the vacuum cleaner realized that that dealer whom I sold vacuum hassek, suddenly his sales went up, suddenly double. So he went to the man and I said, "What did you do? We have all kinds of dealers all over." And they just didn't, I never saw such an increase. He said, "There is a young man that whose name is O.S. Chess, O is Oscar S. Schoenfeld, O.S. Chess Company, and he manufactures me hasek, and now I'm not out of hasek. I have the right color, everything." So that factory sent out all over 300 dealers.
To you.
Not to me, to the vacuum cleaner people. And told them, "If you want to increase your business, go and buy hasek, order out haseks from Oscar Schoenfeld." So I had orders and orders, and I must tell you that the first year, I paid $16,000 tax. $16,000 income tax. Such a big business was it for me. Yeah. People send me in advance money. I got from Wisconsin, Utah. I didn't even never heard of Paris. In advance money, and we send them. So then later on, those most of the companies who sold vacuums cleaners, they went bankrupt. The government closed them down. The business bureau closed them down because they advertised falsely. They advertised on the radio that you can buy from me for $9 a vacuum cleaner, a good used vacuum cleaner, and this how. He got there to the lead. You called in, "Oh, for $9, I'm going to order." And our job, the job of the salesman was to go out to those leads with a $9 hasek, but try to sell them a brand new hasek for $130, $140. And the Better Business Bureau, so that was a false advertisement. So the Better Business Bureau closed them down, and I sold my business to another, to my competitor, who did not realize that the business is down. He didn't know what's happening. He didn't know that the Better Business Bureau is closing them down. So then I was out of that business. I went into another business to manufacture our sliding screen doors. I don't know that if you want to hear that story how it started, and I'm in that business at home. In the meantime, I established a family here.
Tell us the names of your children and when they were born.
Oldest daughter is Esther. The daughter is Esther. She is about when she was born. She's today about 49 years old.
That's good enough.
And I have a son, David, who is 36 years old. And David was, and I have another son, Alan, who is 35 years old. We have a lot of pleasure from them. From my daughter, we have pleasure. He has two children. Eddie is her husband, Eddie Friedman, who is also very involved with the Federation here. He is working in the plant which we have. And David, who didn't like to be in business here, who is not a businessman, he was always like to be with youth. He wants to be youth. He went to camps. He was the camp leader so far and so on. Today David is in Israel with four beautiful children, and he's making a very nice living. And very, very happy. Very, very happy. And Ellen, who has also four children here, beautiful. And they all go in the Hebrew schools. And they all go to one, three of them go to Hillel School. Four of them go to Hillel School. And we shep nachas of them. And I hope that Im Yetzer Hashem, the Bein Shalom is going to watch over us. I belong to a synagogue, Beit Yaakov, Beit Jacob, which is located in Beverly Hills. I was the president of that Beit Jacob. And I'm very active even today. People ask me, why don't I retire? Says, I don't know what to do with myself if I retire. Then, on the second thought, I said, you know, if I'm retired, if I'm going to retire, I'm going to spend my time on a voluntary basis, wherever I can do it, for charity basis. First of all, I have all kinds of projects in Beit Jacob, building makers, anyway. And now I'm involved with a school by name Shal Hevet. It's a new high school in town, my grandson is going there, learning there. And then, Baruch Hashem, there are quite a few organizations. My wife is also very active, especially with Bond of Israel. So what else can I tell you? And I'm here, it's already 1 o'clock. I have the plant, which I have to go to see, the plant. So Baruch Hashem. The only thing I can tell you, and I don't know why, but it took me over 50 years to tell you what I told you. I never wanted to talk about it. I just didn't want to talk about it. My children, whatever they know in the last 2 or 3 years. Because I just somehow, you don't have the koiches to think back on all of what we went through. And so here I am, and I thank you very much that you took the time that I should remember how I was once and how I remember.
I want to thank you for sharing your life story with us. And maybe one last question before we finish.
Please.
This is for your children, your grandchildren, and for historians or whoever watch your testimony. Is there something that you want to leave as maybe a message that you'd like to add, one, or something that you've learned now that you've gone back and gone through your memories, and maybe one last piece of advice or message?
I would like my children and grandchildren. They should remember their parents. They should make sure that they should teach them that they should be decent, clean, cut, Jewish people. One by one, they should love their land. Because if we wouldn't have that land, I wouldn't be here, and they wouldn't be here. To make sure that they should stay Jews and Jewish family, and they should just continue in their Jewish life. That's all which I want to say. If they would do that one, I would be very happy, and I will, when my time comes, I will remember that I did everything for them, that they should be decent people. And love also the United States. So this country is beautiful. This country gave us Penosa, Nachas, Osher, Chavot. It's a great country. And again, thank you very much.
Thank you very, very much. Mr. Schoenfeld, tell us a little bit about this picture.
This picture is my father, my family. We were 11 children. This 11 children, 8 girls and 3 boys. All were alive till 1944, when the German came in. I was a young boy there to the left of the picture. I was that time approximately 13 years old, bar mitzvah.
The boy being whose hair is all shaved off right there.
Yeah, that is me. That is me.
Oscar Schoenfeld.
And the man who is in the center is my oldest brother, who passed away a few years ago here.
Well, we can't tell that. We'll get to him. Let's go across so that we can do it. Who's the little girl sitting just to the, I guess, to the right of you?
The little girl is, her name is Chava Eva. This is she, and the other young girl who sits on my father's lap are the two girls who escaped from the ghetto, from Munkas and from Ungra.
Okay, and then is your father, and his name again?
Dezer, they call him, David.
Okay, and then the woman in the white standing next to him?
In the white. In white is Ilonka, Rivka, who lived in Israel for a few years. Then she came over to Los Angeles, and she is in Los Angeles, living with a beautiful family.
And then the woman next to her?
The woman next to her, her name was Magda. She was our, how should I call that one? She is the oldest one which survived. She was like a mother. She was worried about all of us. She made me, for instance, when I came to United States, it was waiting a job for me in New York to be a Hebrew teacher. And she lived in Los Angeles. And when she heard that I want to stay in Los Angeles, she wrote me a letter to tell me that if I do that one, she doesn't want to know of me, nothing.
You mean that
she unless I come here, because I always dreamed that my family, the family should be together.
Okay, now in the back row.
In the back row, that is.
Right behind them.
That is my brother. His name is Emery or Imre. He went in 1940. He was able to go on Aliyah Beit, I think. Yeah, Aliyah Beit to Palestine. In Palestine, the war broke out, and they were waiting to have a chance to go to fight the Nazis. So there was an occasion that the Czech Brigade was in Palestine, and there he was volunteering to go in that brigade with his brother, who was the oldest one. And he was fighting during the war in France, and 3 weeks before the war ended, he was killed on the front in Normandy.
And the woman next to him?
The woman next to him is Luisa. Her name is also Chemda. All my sisters' names are Hebrew names like Tova, Chemda, Yafa, Hana, Rivka.
And Chemda, did she survive?
Chemda, no, she didn't survive. Chemda didn't survive, and the two girls which are on the left side, or the right side of me.
Right above you.
Above me, yes.
Well, let's not skip. So next to Chemda is another brother, and his name?
Alois, or his name is Ali. He also, like I said, went to university, learned and finished to be an architect. He was able to go to Palestine with his brother, with Imre. And he was also in the Czech Legion fighting the Nazis at the front. He happened to be lucky, and he came home.
And next to him?
Next to him is a sister whose name is Hana. Hana was a Hebrew teacher in the elementary school. She finished the gymnasium in Munkács. She went to some special courses to learn the technique of teaching, and she was a teacher till 1939. In 1939, she married a professor from the Hebrew gymnasium, who was very, everybody loved him. His name was Bergenbaum. And both of them in the year 1939, they gave up their teaching and they were chalutzim. Bergenbaum, her husband, was the one who established the chalutz hatzair in not just in Munkács, but in Carpathian Rus, which is part of Czechoslovakia at that time. And they went on Aliyah, they got certificate, went to a kibbutz, even though the both of them were professional teachers, they went to a kibbutz and they worked in the fields.
And quickly, the names of the other two sisters?
The other two sisters is Tova, which is Gizi, and Yafa, which is beautiful.
Beautiful. And the woman sitting next to you was
my mother.
And her name was?
Ethel. What? You just call her mother.
Thank you very much.
The gentleman is my brother, who I mentioned. He was in Palestine. And
give us your brother's name.
Imre, Emery, or Yisrael, because he was in Palestine, and everybody called him Yisrael.
Schoenfeld. Right.
And
this picture was taken when?
This picture must be taken during his military year. Must be in 1943, 44.
Do you know what country it was taken in?
Most probably in Palestine.
Okay.
Most probably, I think so. But He wrote to his to my sister in Israel a letter, which I have the letter with me, that he feels already that the war is ending and finally is going to be home. And 3 weeks after, 3 weeks before the war ended, he was killed in the battle. We don't know where he was buried. We knew that he was in Normandy, but we didn't know exactly where in Normandy. So Ellis and I, we went to France one day, and we were able to locate the place where he is buried. He is buried right now near Arras, and that is a Czech cemetery, a Czechoslovakian cemetery. And when I went, and names were there, 80% of them were Jewish names, and I didn't see one Magen David. And I came to see this picture, and again, a Christ was on him.
Cross.
And I made sure that after the war, the local, the friends, the local Kehila help, they changed the cross and they put in Magen David. If anybody goes to Arras, right there is, you will see the Czech legion. And it's very interesting to say about finally we found where he is buried. But he didn't die there where he's buried. After the war, they took all the heroes, all the men who passed away, and they put them in special, in decent cemeteries. So we did not know exactly where he lives, where he was
buried.
One day, when we were in Haifa visiting, it was a rainy day, staying in the hotel, Carmel, and I said to my wife, let's go out to see the city. It's raining, so what? We will take a taxi and we will go. And we got into a taxi. And I told for the taxi that my name is Schoenfeld, and it was too hard for him to speak to us in English. He can speak to us Hebrew because we understand. Suddenly that man, the driver, looks in his center mirror, I noticed, and he asked me, what name did you tell me? I said, Schoenfeld is my name. Did you have a brother by name of Imre? Yeah, sure, I had a brother. Was your brother in the Czech Legion? He says, yes. Then he stopped and he said, I buried your brother.
And that's the picture?
And that's the picture which he took.
In 1944.
That is the place where he was first buried.
Thank you. Go ahead.
On this picture, this is our wedding picture. Oscar and Alice Schoenfeld were married in New York after knowing her for so many. There's a story to it, but it's too long, that story.
So this was taken in 1950?
Taken in 1952.
Thank you. This was a picture taken.
This building is our house, the back side of the house. I was in Europe, we went to Munkacs, and I spent at least 4 hours there. That's all. Because I knew that every step which I'm going, there were heroes walking there before the war.
This was taken again about 10 years ago, 1980?
Yeah, somewhere around 10 or 12 years ago, still under communism.
So about 1987, 88?
Yeah, it's possible, yeah. 1988, 1987, it's possible. This picture is a building, the Hebrew Gymnasium, which it was built around 1925. This is the only building which is still stays as it was.
In Munkacs.
In Munkacs. This is the Hebrew Gymnasium, and I met those two other persons, people whom I knew before the war. This is the school which it gave us all the knowledge which we had.
So this was taken again in late 80s?
Yeah, somewhere around that time.
89, in Munkacs.
This picture is on the part of the left side is the Beit HaMidrash HaGadol. And this Beit HaMidrash was open 7 days a week, 24 hours, and that was hundreds and hundreds yeshivot bachurim, they were learning that.
And this is taken in Munkacs?
And this was taken in 1989 in Munkacs by Oscar Schoenfeld. This picture is my family. Here I am with my oldest sister, Magda, with her husband.
Okay,
whose name was Klein.
Okay, now you are standing in the white shirt, Oscar Schoenfeld.
That's correct,
and sitting right below, let's start, sitting right
below. Sitting right below is my sister, Irene, with her husband, Leslie Markley. And the other lady who is sitting is my sister, Rivka, mm-hmm. who lives here. As I told you, in 1942, she was able to go to Israel, and a few years ago, she came by.
And then standing on top of her
is again the sister which I helped to escape from the ghetto. She and the person who is sitting in the left corner is Irene. This picture is done in the backyard of our house.
In Beverly Hills.
In Beverly Hills, I must say about 6-7 years ago.
So about 1992. And, yeah. And the gentleman sitting with the cane?
That is, his name is Klein Zoli, who was the husband of my sister Magda, who stands behind him.
Okay.
This picture is a family's picture. And this picture is my, naturally, my wife.
Well, let's go around and see. Let's start here all the way on the right-hand side facing us. You've got sitting with a little boy on her lap. Now tell us who they are.
This is my daughter-in-law. Behind her is, with white shirt, is her husband, David, who are now in Israel, live in Israel.
And her name is, your daughter-in-law's name?
Barbara.
Barbara Schoenfeld.
Yeah, Barbara.
And the little boy?
And the little boy must be the first, Ariel. Oh, my gosh. I cannot tell you the names.
It's okay. It's the grandchildren.
But all of them. There are 10 grandchildren. No, they are not 10 grandchildren. They are just, I think, 8.
On this picture. On that picture. Okay, so that your son. And then next to him in the suit.
That is my brother-in-law, Leslie Markley. And next to her is my sister, Irene, I think. It's hard for me to...
Can you put on your glasses? Can you see them? Yeah. Can we see them? Can you still see them? Okay. Go ahead.
It's hard for me to tell you. Next to him is Eddie Friedman with... My brother.
Okay, go ahead.
It's hard for me to. Next is Eddie Friedman with my daughter Esther. Mm-hmm. And that is with the baby. The young man is Ellen with his son, Carmiel, all of them, Schoenfeld. There's the picture of Hannah, of my sister, who was visiting us from Israel here, who lives in the kibbutz right now. And Baruch Hashem, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 grandchildren. Today we have 10 grandchildren.
And this is taken in Los Angeles?
This is taken in 1997. In the year 1997.
In
Los Angeles, in our home. And since that time, the grandchildren, we have an additional 2 grandchildren, so a total of 10 grandchildren, beautiful persons. If I would know that it's such a great nachas you have from grandchildren, I would start to work on grandchildren only.
Okay. Thank you very much.